Morning. Welcome. Welcome to church this morning on the first Sunday of Lent, a time of penitence and spiritual renewal, and we begin our preparations for Easter. We welcome back Miku and Yuki, who will be singing for us this morning. And before we begin the service, Anthony is going to teach us another song, a song that we're going to sing each Sunday in Lent, and it's the one that is on the third page towards the bottom. It says, prayers of intercession. During the prayers we will sing seated, and then what follows on.
Good morning, everyone. As Vaughan said, we're going to be doing this all through Lent, which is a good thing because it's a very long tune and it's a lot to learn in one day. So we'll get started. Give me your hand.
Give me your hand.
Let us be forever.
Let us be forever.
On the lifelong path.
On the lifelong path.
Companions now together.
Companions now together.
Give me your hand.
Give me your hand.
Sister, wherever we travel.
Sister, wherever we travel.
Give me your hand.
Give me your hand.
Brother on narrow pathways.
Brother on narrow pathways.
Okay, we're about halfway. Give me your hand.
Give me your hand.
Let us steadfast be in love.
Let us steadfast be in love.
And move towards where peace abides.
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 Cool, and the last bit gets a bit groovier.
Give us your hand, O God. Give us your hand, O God.
Guide us in our living.
Guide us in our living.
Grant us your forgiving.
Grant us your forgiving.
Give us your hand.
Give us your hand.
Good, well done, everyone. Thank you.
And our service focuses on the story of Jesus in the wilderness. And we begin with this psalm, this very traditional psalm for beginning of Lent, Psalm 51. Perhaps if we divide it up so people on my... Is this right? Yeah, people on this side, on the right side, say the ordinary type, and people on this side say the bowl types. How's that? Okay, so you start. Have mercy on me, O God, in your great goodness. According to the abundance of your compassion, blot out my offenses. Wash me thoroughly from my wickedness, and cleanse me from my sin. for I acknowledge my faults, and my sin is ever before me. Against you only have I sinned, and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and righteous in your judgment. I have been wicked even from my birth, a sinner when my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth deep within me, and shall make me understand wisdom in the depths of my heart. Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear of joys and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. Turn your face from my sins, and blot out all my misdeeds. Make me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Give me again the joy of your salvation, and sustain me with your gracious spirit. Then shall I teach your ways to the wicked, and sinners shall return to you. Deliver me from my guilt, O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall proclaim your praise. For you desire no sacrifice, else I would give it. You take no delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifice of God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. Sing 40 days and 40 nights.
And 40 nights thou wast fasting in the wild. 40 days and 40 nights tempted and yet undefiled. Some beam scorching all the day, chilly dew drops night prowling bees about thy way, stones thy pillow, earth thy bed. Shall not we thy sorrow share, and from worldly joys abstain, fasting with unceasing prayer, glad with thee to suffer pain? And if Satan vexing storm, flesh or spirit should assail, thou his vanquisher before, grant we may not faint nor fail. Shall we have peace divine, holier gladness all shall be. Round us too shall angels shine, such as minister to thee. Keep, O keep us, Saviour dear, constant by thy side, that with thee we may appear at the eternal Eastertide.
We come to God in prayer, and at the end of our prayer we will join together in the little litany on the sheet. you saying the bold, and I saying the plain. God, you love the world so much that you embraced it in all its suffering, in your beloved Jesus Christ, who sought the way of the cross that he might come to Easter and offer us the way back to you. We thank you for this space apart, not just on this Sunday morning, but in the weeks that are to come, space to become more receptive to the incredible promise of new life, life to challenge all that is deathly in our world, life to challenge all that is dull in our hearts. Help us to use this time, not just in prayer at worship, but in the thoughtfulness in which we go about these coming days, listening for your voice in all we do, as you challenge the habits that restrict us and the assumptions that close our minds. Help us also to be aware of others who at this time are examining themselves, whether from religious duty or because they have reached a turning point in a career or in a relationship or in a crisis. Give us an ear that listens, that we may find the words to sustain and the openness to learn through Jesus Christ, our deliverance and our hope. Amen. For each step that we might take, be our guide, O Lord of life. For each load that we might bear, be our strength, O Lord of life. For each mountain we might face, be our power, O Lord of life. For each river that might impede, be our safety, O Lord of life. For each place where we might rest, be our peace, O Lord of life. For each sunrise and sunset, be our joy, O Lord of life.
Our first reading comes from Genesis chapter 9, verses 8 to 17. Then God said to Noah and his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." Amen.
Lord, what a menagerie. Between your downpour and these animal cries, one cannot hear oneself think. The days are long, Lord. All this water makes my heart sing. When will the ground cease to rock under my feet? These days are long. Master Raven has not come back. Here is your dove. Will she find a twig of hope? The days are long. Lord, guide your ark to safety. Some zenith of rest where we can escape at last from this brute slavery. The days are long. Lord, lead me until I reach the shore of your covenant. Amen.
Und bleibt der Krieg.
Freude, Sonne, Bart, Gelang. Second reading is from chapter 1, verses 9 to 15. In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved, with you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness for 40 days, tempted by Satan, who was with the wild beasts, and the angels waiting for him. And after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news."
We sing, "Praise the one who breaks the darkness."
Praise the one who breaks the darkness with a liberating light. Praise the one who frees the prisoners, turning blindness into sight. Praise the one who preached the gospel in every dread disease, calming storms and feeding thousands with the very bread of peace. Praise the one who blessed the children with a strong yet gentle word. Praise the one who drove out demons with a piercing two-edged sword. Praise the one who brings cool water to the desert's burning sand. From this well comes living water, quenching thirst in every land. Praise the one true love incarnate, Christ who suffered in our place. Jesus died and rose for many, that we may know God by grace.
Let us sing
for joy and gladness, seeing what our God has done. Praise the one redeeming glory, praise the one who makes us one.
And the spirits immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness for 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. That's it. Mark does not mess about. He tells the story of Jesus as a small child would breathlessly tell of something exciting that has happened. Mark's two favorite words are in this little two verses. Immediately, that's one of his favorite words, and the Spirit, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. Immediately after his baptism and the divine acclamation, the Spirit drives him out into the wilderness. The wilderness is an uncultivated land, desert, forest, shrubland, outside of civilization, a liminal space of wandering and seeking. The Israelites wandered in the wilderness for 40 years after their escape from slavery, searching for a permanent home. The wilderness is a scary place. It's not the place to settle and make a home. And yet the Spirit forces Jesus into that space. Adam and Eve, our first parents, were driven out of the cultivated Garden of Eden into the earth as we know it, with its untidiness, its confusion, its aggression. And God drove them out into a hostile wilderness and instructed them to cultivate it. And the Spirit likewise forced Jesus to enter a dangerous, uncivilized space. Traditionally, we begin Lent with a reflection on the wilderness experience of Jesus. It is important in his story, a moment of identification with the human condition, with our condition. And we all have times when our world feels untidy, confused, hostile, dangerous. And while he is there, Jesus had three non-human encounters. First with Satan, who tested Jesus. And there were the angels there to protect him. And Jesus is in the middle of a massive conflict between the challenges of the demonic forces in his world, we know them too, and the hospitality of the angels. The same angels who fed the Israelites in the wilderness, sent by the same God who commands us to feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, and welcome the stranger in our midst. And while Jesus receives comfort from the angels, he finds himself in some other very strange company. Mark said he was with the wild beasts. This painting by Stanley Spencer, showing Christ in the wilderness with the eagles, shows that there was no sign of animosity in the phrase "with the wild beasts." And we know about the wild beasts of ancient Palestine from Scripture. There were wolves, leopards, lions, bears, snakes. And the Bible makes a distinction between domestic and wild animals. Mind you, so do we. It will not take you long on social media before you see a video of a cat or a cute dog. Children learn to live with the animal world, with the pet mice, rabbits, gerbils, goldfish. Adults too become devoted to their pets, and these days spend a fortune on them. Wild animals, however, frighten us. Being with a wild animal is a specialist skill. You can be a zookeeper or a wildlife photographer, but you and I would be wise to stay out of the lion's cage. Jesus, however, is with the wild beasts. He's not working within the conventional boundaries of domestic and wild civilization and wilderness. He's in a new space. The calling of Jesus is the restoration of Eden, beginning with the transformation of the fearsome place of Adam and Eve's banishment. Behind me is this troublesome relic that we have in this church, a piece of Plymouth Rock, where the Pilgrim Fathers first landed in the Americas. The Pilgrims, our forebears, identified themselves totally with the biblical story. seeing themselves as Israelites journeying towards the promised land. They saw America as a wilderness which God wanted them to tame. They saw the land and its inhabitants as a threat, and their mission was to transform it into a new Eden. As they say, the rest is history. Didn't they do well? We cannot really compare ourselves to the first hearers of the gospel who have understood the wilderness to be a threat. Ours is quite a different situation. It's not the wild animals and the desert places that are a threat to humanity, but the reverse. We live in an urbanized space surrounded by the noise of traffic and the smell of petrol fumes. Nature is sanitized in packaged meat and processed food. Our habitat is concrete, and nature struggles to find room in the pavement cracks and limited green space. And so many wild species are in danger because of us. We encroach on their habitat and threaten to turn their wilderness into an uninhabitable wasteland. And of the animals Jesus would have met, some have become extinct in the region over the past 100 years. The wild ass, the desert oryx, the addax, the ostrich, and no doubt others. There are factors at play which affect their natural habitats: industrial scale farming and fishing, the expansion of cities, deforestation, mining and oil extraction, changes to the seabed caused by trawling for fish, pollutants. All of these factors contribute to the food we eat and the lifestyle we enjoy. Our modern world has forgotten to respect the wilderness, to allow the wild to be wild, and the consequences are catastrophic. This is likely to be the hottest February ever. And yet we do not have an agreed international settlement to prevent further extreme weather events, flood, fire, storms. In India, Spain, Germany, Greece, France, England and Wales, farmers are protesting, maybe sometimes with good reason, but protesting governmental measures for environmental protection. They say no farmers, no food, and they're right. Yet the continued use of nitrates within industrial farming and fishing will result in no food, no farmers. But there are other stories of wild animals in Scripture, the most well-known being the story of Noah. The animals and birds who secured a ticket to board Noah's boat were both domestic and wild. And did you notice that Genesis uses the same phrase as Mark? Or Mark uses the same phrase as Genesis, I suppose. In the story, God says, "As for me, I am establishing a covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you. The birds, the domestic animals, and every animal on the earth with you, as many as come out of the ark." In the wilderness, Jesus relived the liberation story of the Exodus and their 40-year journey in the desert, fed by manna from heaven. But he's also reliving the story of Noah, escaping from a deluge of overpowering floodwaters. Noah creates a place of rescue for humanity and the diversity of species we need to live. Noah's ark is a metaphor for the church. It's a place of shelter, of refuge from the storm, of rescue, salvation. And after the flood, God makes a promise that there will be no more existential threats to human life. And yet that threat is now real. As the spiritual says, God gave Noah the rainbow sign, no more flood, the fire next time. But take note that the covenant is not between humanity and God, but between God, humanity, and every living creature. We are facing a new existential threat, not because God has broken the promise, but because we have forgotten that there was a third party to Noah's covenant. In both the prophecies of Daniel and the book of Revelation, the symbol of the beast stands for the oppressive empires of the world. We know of 666, the mark of the beast, which referred to the Roman Empire, the power which finally put Jesus to death. The beast is biblical shorthand for the empires of the world. And of course, the forces which have led to the predicament of contemporary humanity are complex. Yet there is a dynamic, intellectual, economic, political, ethical, and ecological, coming together to create disorder, a beast in the wilderness masking a civilization. And Jesus is not an appeaser of the beast. In his struggle between the testing Satan and the hospitality of the angelic ministry, Jesus transformed the beast. This encounter defines his ministry, his life, and his death. And it should also define our way of being in the wilderness. Far from the beast overwhelming him, Jesus turns to the covenant with Noah and the liberation of Moses. And those two breathless verses of our text, with their sense of urgency and dynamism, spell out a mission to radically transform our relationships with all our fellow human beings, the diversity of species on our planets, the habitats of rivers, oceans, forests, farmlands, urban spaces, and with the systems and structures which sustain our economic and social lives. Sure, this is a global mission outside our competency to bring about, but in truth, there will be no resolution of global climate change, prevention of future epidemics, an ending of war and conflict, positive migration flows, without a return to Noah's covenant and Jesus's way of being with the wild beasts. There's a reminder of this in the prophecy of Hosea. God says, I will make for you a covenant on that day with the wild animals, the birds of the air and the creeping things of the ground, and I will abolish the bow, the sword, and war from the land, and I will make you lie down in safety. The future sustenance and security of humanity depends upon a return to the covenant God made with Noah, a covenant born out of environmental collapse. Lent is an inner spiritual journey. Our readings today remind us that the inner journey is not selfish. This is an inner journey through which we restore broken relationships within ourselves, but also with our neighbors, our communities, and with nature and the world around us. Lent is a time for prayer, and today's reflections on our text informs our prayers for a new settlement between government, farmers, consumers, and creation itself. Jesus did not just think, I feel like going into the wilderness today. It was the Spirit that drove him there. And may the Spirit also direct us into new patterns of thinking, new ways of being in this world. And may the angels also protect us. Amen. We sing On Eagle's Wings.
To you, a famine will bring you no fear.
terrors of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand. For to his angels he's given a command to guard you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, lest you dash your foot against the stone. And he will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Let us pray. Hold in our minds the words of the psalmist. The Lord upholds all those who fall and lifts up all who are bowed down. God of love, hear the cry of those who yearn for love. Fractured families, broken homes, neglected, unwanted, alone. God of love, hear our prayer. God of justice, hear the cry of those who yearn for justice, persecuted and oppressed, exploited, ill-treated, broken. God of justice, hear our prayer. God of peace, hear the cry of those who yearn for peace, in battle zones, in broken states, frightened, fearful, anxious. God of prayer, God of peace, hear our prayer. God of healing, hear the cry of those who yearn for healing, physical and spiritual, hurting, weakened, depressed. God of healing, hear our prayer. God of mercy, hear the cry of those who yearn for mercy, convicted, in need of your grace, contrite, humble, bowed down. God of mercy, hear our prayer. I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. And because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. May you know the peace of God, the love of God, the justice of God, the healing and mercy of God this day and all days. Amen. Give me your hand. Let us be forever.
Travel, give me your hand.
move towards where peace abides. Give us your hand, O God, guide us in our living. Grant us your forgiving. Give us your hand.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Christe misse auf der Erde, Christi Walle.
Thank you.
Christe misse.
Thank you so much. That was really amazing. Both of you, thank you. Thanks everybody for coming along. Of course, special thank you to Miku and Yuki. And to Anthony back there. To Vaughan. To Constantine and Poria. And our readers who were Sue
and Gary.
And Gary. Thank you very much, both of you. I forget a lot nowadays. It's terrible. It's not great. Thank you, though. Thank you so much for reading. And I think that's everyone to thank. Thank you so much, everybody, for coming along as well, of course. Right, let's get the right sheet out. So, events. Our next event is an evening Teze chant and prayer. Last week we had a wonderful Ash Wednesday music event, which was great. Claudine is there, she was taking part. That's gonna be nice. It's gonna be a more kind of churchy event, but yeah, Teze chant and prayer.
What?
Teze chant and prayer, it's gonna be pretty darn good. It's gonna be really nice. And we can grow together in Christ and in the Holy Spirit. So amen to that. Then we've got, this is going to be kind of one of the top events, I think. It's Secret Believers. It's about Christians in Iran. We've got Mansour Bourji and Robert Assyrian, who are both experts on religious persecution in Iran, and I guess in the occupied territory as well. So please come along to that. That's going to be really good. And then this one's sold out. The next one is actually sold out, but it's gotta be one you've gotta come to, really. So you should come anyway. And I'll probably be on the door and let you in. So it's we've got some very cool speakers. So Halale, who's founder of Muso, who's actually Kurdish, fought against the Shah and then fought against the Islamic Republic in her youth as a freedom fighter. We've got three women, Mersal, Sadia, and Fakira from Afghanistan through the Refugee and Migrant Service of Islington Together. And I think her name's, I can't remember what her name is. I don't think Nandita's told me her name, actually, but we've got a woman coming, a speaker, who is a woman from through Camden Abudis Friendship Association, who we've collaborated with in the past, who do stuff on Palestine. So that's gonna be a really good event, and they're all gonna come and speak about their experiences. Come along to that. That's going to be really good. And then we've got a film screening, Six Inches of Soil. This is nearly sold out, this one. but it's about farmers, British farmers, kind of doing things differently to the big conglomerate farming organizations who dominate farming in this country. So that's going to be really interesting. Come along again. It might be sold out by the time you look, but oh well. And then we've got our passion play, The Devil's Passion. This is starring and written by Justin Butcher, who, I mean, I've probably said it before, but he's like my friend's dad in school, which is kind of weird. But the play actually looks really good and really serious. And there isn't a time. The time is usually 6:30 doors, 7:30 start, something like that. Yeah, there should be times on this, so. Oh yeah, events all at 7, but okay. But except that one, and except the Good Friday concert. All of them are at 7, except for the last two, which are at 7:30. Yeah, don't you forget. And then the last one is our Good Friday concert with Union Chapel Voices. Oh my gosh, Voices, singer here, oh my goodness. And the Spirituals, oh my gosh. So the two best choirs in the world, the two best gospel choirs in the world. Thank you so much, God bless.
And Bible study on Tuesday, forgotten, and the church meeting as well on Thursday. Arglwydd arwain drwy'r anialwch. Pantacelyn's great hymn, Guide me, O thou great Jehovah. Redeemer.
Guide me, O thou great Redeemer, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven,
Brothers and sisters, since we are surrounded by such a huge crowd of witnesses to the life of faith, let us rid our lives of every weight that slows us down, especially the sin that so easily hinders our progress, and let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us, knowing that the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit goes with us. Amen.